Hello, everyone. Welcome. My name is Kambiz Ranavardi, ColumbiaDC board member and a graduate of the School of Engineering and Applied Science. This evening, we are honored to have Lorraine Marchand, General Manager of Life Sciences at IBM Watson Health and Adjunct Professor of Management at Columbia Business School, to talk about the innovation mindset and 8 essential steps to transform any industry, which happens to be the title of Lorraine's most recent book, published by Columbia University Press. I believe you have received the link to the book and a discount code in your confirmation and reminder emails. And we will share it again within 24 hours of this session with the recording. Lorraine serves on the healthcare and pharmaceutical management program advisory board at CVS, but she also held in private sector executive roles in management, operations, and business development for companies such as Bristol Myers Squibb, Covance, CliniLab, and Cognizant Technology Solutions. She also co-founded 2 life sciences companies. She holds degrees from Columbia, London Business School, American University, and University of Maryland. So she is local. Welcome back. She received awards of distinction from Bristol Myers Squibb and NIH. And in 2014, she was the recipient of the Pennsylvania Governor's Hannah Penn Leadership Award. So without further ado, Lorraine, it's all yours.
All right. Well, thank you very much, Cambriz. It's saying, here we go. Okay. So I want to be able to share my screen. There we go. All right. Is the voice loud and clear?
Everything is great.
Oh, terrific. Well, first of all, Kembiz, I can't thank you enough for giving me the honor of addressing the CBSDC Metro Alumni Club. Hello, Columbians. I was a graduate of the EMBA 06 program, which was the global program at Columbia and London. So it's great to be here with you tonight. And I do originally hail from the DC area. I moved to the Philadelphia, New York corridor in about 2000 when I joined the company Bristol Myers Squibb. But certainly my heart is in DC and much of my academic credentials are as well. I was also at the National Institutes of Health. I worked on K Street at one of the Omnicom companies, Porter Novelli. So it's indeed a pleasure to be back virtually. And I'm really delighted to have an opportunity to share with you some of the highlights and insights that I've gleaned as I wrote this book, The Innovation Mindset. And I thought what I would do is really break it into 3 parts. I'd like to talk with you about the idea of what is an innovation mindset, because of course, innovation starts with the innovator, herself or himself. So what are those behaviors? What are those characteristics, those practices that help embody innovation in each of us? I also want to talk a little bit about what innovation is so that we have a little bit of a lexicon to guide us today. A lot of times individuals will tell me that they don't think they're innovative, they don't think they're creative, they're not going to design the next Uber or Airbnb. And I say, that's okay. Innovation is for all of us and we can all participate in it. And my book really gives us step by step what you can do in terms of putting some what I call laws of innovation in practice, so that if you have an idea and you're interested in a startup, or if you're in a corporation, I've spent much of my career in the corporate world, as you've seen, and I've had to be an innovator or entrepreneur in a large organization. And so with those 2 ideas as bookends, I believe that if you follow this disciplined methodology, you too can have commercial success with your innovation. And then, of course, it's really important that we that we inculcate innovation within the culture. We're all leaders. We're all here as business leaders around the virtual meeting room today. And so we have an opportunity to embody innovation, to share those characteristics, which I'll show you in a minute. I flashed them kind of quickly there, and to make sure that we inculcate it in the values and the culture of the organizations that we're in the organizations that we lead and manage. So we have to really first start by saying to ourselves, why do we care about innovation? I'll get to the mindset in just a minute, but why do we even care about innovation? And for those of us who have been in the exposed to technology for any number of years, when I was at the University of Maryland, I actually started out as a computer science major. And I can remember having to go into the comp sci lab with the big Fortran and basic programming that we had to do on the big mainframes. And after you'd written your program, you had to punch it into these key cards. And, you know, a project just took weeks. So, you know, when we think about that, the way we use computed technology, to the 1984 introduction of the Mac, which at the time sold for $2,500. And then if we move full circle to our current day, you know, the ability to, in a very small device with, you know, thousands of gigabytes and ability to store and memory and compute power, that, you know, within our hand, we have the ability to touch just about anybody and anything. And I also just wanted to comment, and I will stop and ask if ComBiz, if you see questions in the chat. I really should have said that at the beginning, and I apologize that I didn't mention this, but I'm really interested in what you'd like to get out of this session. I don't have the ability to really see and go back and forth in the chat and the view that I have, but certainly post your questions. And if there are certain things that you want me to cover that we'll discuss in the Q&A, I really want this session to be designed in a way that meets your needs.
Yeah, I just want to add, Lorraine, that people, whenever you have questions, just don't use chat. Please put it in Q&A box and we will address it in the second half in the order received. So, if you're ready for it.
Thank you. But you know, to pause here, even though Steve Jobs and certainly the Mac and the iPhone represent what we might consider quintessential innovation, if we think about current day, I'm sure a number of us are exposed and involved in current day innovations that are just as transformative. For example, in CIO Magazine just today, there was a piece about the Army's warfighting cloud and the first ever U.S. Army CIO, Dr. Raj Iyer, who's really discussing the game-changing way that they've been able to define military intelligence and military impact, not in ammunition, but in the power of data and AI. And with what they've been able to set up in the cloud and the AI and the data that they've been able to transmit to the Ukraine, been very instrumental in helping them to thwart some of Russia's advances on them. So a great example of innovation right in our own fabulous city of DC. And it's also important, I think, to think about the impact that COVID has had. There's so much negativity, obviously, around COVID, but I believe that it created a wonderful, perfect situation for any number of innovations to be developed. I mean, I would imagine that we wouldn't be sitting around the virtual room today, 90 strong and 300 people that have registered for this particular event and able to offer it and we can all participate if it hadn't been for COVID and really the movement toward virtual meetings. And so as much as they can be the bane of our existence on certain days and we get a little overloaded with Zoom meetings and the camera, but you think about what it's given us access to has really been amazing. And we think about the other advances that it's created in terms of the partnership, for example, between Medtronic and Tesla, which allowed for these mobile ventilators to be put in senior centers and other difficult to reach places so that patients didn't have to go into hospital. So I'm sure you all have your own examples as well, but just to say that innovation, of course, is very important and it's advancing every aspect of society and culture. And I wanted to also mention, by popping up the faces of Edison and also Gates, along with Steve Jobs, that again, you know, these are quintessential innovators. Why are they quintessential? What do they have in common? Well, to me, the definition of an innovator is someone with an insatiable curiosity, a passion for problem solving, and embracing change. And I'm sure that you might be able to add other words to that, but those are really important characteristics to me. And so I want to stop. I'll just have a quick quiz on these two next two slides, because I like to get you involved early on. I would like to know if anybody knows these innovators and their innovations. And so this first one, you may not know that it was Satoshi Nakamoto who observed the banking bailout of 08, and sensed the customers were vulnerable to inefficiencies in the banking system. He created a secure, transparent transaction system, now known as blockchain and Bitcoin, an immutable, transparent ledger to record every financial transaction that occurs between buyers and sellers. And we're all so aware now of all of the different applications of Bitcoin and blockchain. So a great example of innovation, but a name that might not be as well known as Edison and Jobs and Gates, but still very important. I really like this one because this is Cyrus Mosumi. He ruptured his eardrum on a flight to New York. And I should also mention when this occurred in 07, that Cyrus is a graduate of CBS. So he's an alum in our midst. He couldn't find a doctor to see him in New York City on short notice, and spent an entire day in the emergency room. If you've ever been to New York and had to deal with the medical system, you can only imagine what that must have been like. And after that experience, he founded ZocDoc, a marketplace that matches patients with doctors in real time, lets you book an appointment with available doctors on a smartphone. He has since left the company, but ZocDoc continues. And another innovation that we all may be aware of, but and maybe we've heard her story, but it was Robin Chase, who needed a way to get directly to her destination in Boston from New York in a hurry. She couldn't afford a car service. She couldn't wait for a train. So she paid a friend, borrowed her car for a one-way trip to Boston. She and Anshi Danielson created Zipcar, a consumer-to-consumer rental car company that was purchased by Avis in 2013. So I like to bring these examples up because they also help to embody the fact that innovation is not something that's way out there, difficult for us to reach. It's oftentimes problems that we experience in our own day-to-day. And I really want to come back to this point as I go through this talk. Now, this is another quiz because I think that innovation is also something that should be represented equitably. And I personally want to do everything that I can to make it accessible to everyone, genders, races, et cetera. And I think there's a lot of effort now that's going into helping to create more heterogeneity in the innovator and the entrepreneurial community. So you won't be able to answer my question, but you know, maybe silently to yourself, does anybody know who the lady is in the upper left-hand corner? I'll give you just a moment. And her invention was radium. And this is Marie Curie, Madame Curie. So you might be well aware now that she certainly discovered radium and the precursors to what is currently now the ability to perform radiation therapy. And she was so dedicated and passionate about her pursuit of her science that she actually would carry the pellets around in her lab coat. And unfortunately, she ended up passing away from a cancer that was induced by her own exposure to radiation. She is buried in the Sorbonne. And word has it that she still is radioactive today, but certainly someone who was very passionate about her science. If we move down the slide here to the bottom left, I'd like you to take a look at this individual and see if you can think about what she might have been associated with. There was a Netflix series that was created about this individual. It was released earlier in the year. And her name is Madam C.J. Walker. And she was the very first African-American self-made millionaire. And she solved a problem that she experienced, which was unruly hair. And she developed a certain kind of tonic that was very conducive to relaxing the hair of African-American women in her community. And she went out to make it quite a famous product. In our upper right-hand corner is a very famous actress. Maybe you would recognize that she's quite attractive. And what many people don't know is that Hedy Lamarr, while she was a beautiful actress, actually with a colleague developed a naval sonar that had the ability to scramble the submarine signals that were coming in from the World War II Axis power vehicles. Now, during the time that she developed this innovation, the military was very sensitive about the fact that an innovation really shouldn't come from a woman. So they sort of put it in a drawer for a while, but eventually they did bring the technology into the fore. And it's really the precursor of Wi-Fi and GPS as we know it today. So I like to include Hedy Lamarr. These women are all in an Innovator Hall of Fame in a special chapter that I have in the back of my book on innovation and women. And I created my own Hall of Fame with some of my very favorite women innovators. And then I wanted to include a current day innovator. And this individual, this is Martine Rothblatt. And, you know, certainly she was very involved in satellite radio, but what individuals don't know about her as well is that she had a young child when she was 9 years old who was diagnosed with a rare heart condition. And Martine was just so passionate and such an innovator and so curious that she ended up founding a biotech company. And they developed the one drug that was a treatment for this condition that benefited her very own daughter. So again, that insatiable curiosity, that passion for problem solving, that embracing of change, and you don't have to be the quintessential iconic Jobs or Edison or Gates in order to have a tremendous impact. I'd like to share my story with you because you've seen a little bit about my professional background, but I like to share the story of how I became a won over by the idea of being an innovator. And when I was 13 years old, my father, who was an inventor, so he was an inventor, always tinkering, he sort of predated the word innovation, which was really coined when companies wanted to bring their new ideas and their new technologies to market for commercial purposes. Before that, you had huge companies like Bell Labs and IBM who innovated or invented for the purposes of filing patents and improving their products. So that was the era that my dad was in. But to get back to my story, he wanted to impress upon my brother and I the importance of being curious and solving problems. And growing up, he always insisted that we find three solutions to any problem we encountered. And the point was really brought home one summer when he took us to the Hot Shops cafeteria in the Baltimore, Washington area. And our job, as we sat at the big red vinyl booths, eating our breakfast of scrambled eggs and orange juice, was to observe and determine what was slowing down table turnover. So after several days of using our stopwatch, interviewing busboys and waitresses, taking notes in our marble composition books, we determined that the culprit were sugar packets. And these pesky sugar packets, as the sugar was being dispensed in the coffee and tea, they were being crumpled up on the floor and taking extra time to clean up. But true to my dad, we didn't stop there. We had to come up with three solutions, and we had to take one of them to a minimal viable prototype, which I'll talk about in a moment. And we did. We came up with different solutions, liquid sugar, different kinds of receptacles. But ultimately, what we landed on was a product that we called the sugar cube. It held the packets, it held the discarded wrappers. And then in order to make sure that it had value, just beyond being a sugar dispenser, it had four sides to it. And so local advertisers could put their advertisements in it. Well, we took it to the manager of that particular Hot Shops in Maryland, and she loved it. In fact, she loved it so much that she introduced us to the regional and the district managers. And within about 6 months, our product was in the Hot Shops cafeteria throughout the Baltimore, Washington area. So at a young age, I learned that being curious was a good thing. Problem solving was fun and also lucrative. And from then on, it's just been very much inculcated in my DNA and the way that I think. And so to me, the innovation mindset is very much about having a problem solving orientation. Now, as we talk a little bit about what innovation is, and in a way to potentially demystify it for us, I'd like to share a couple examples. So I would imagine that at least some of you are familiar with this product. So Rogaine has been on the market for about 25 years now. It's used to treat male pattern baldness. But what many individuals don't realize is that the Upjohn company was actually testing the chemical in Rogaine for a certain kind of heart condition. And back in those days, it was in the era of blockbuster drugs for cardiovascular disease and cholesterol. And so the clinical trials were contained white middle-aged men who just happened to have male pattern baldness. So what they observed in the trial was that the men started to grow hair. But what's interesting about the story is that the Upjohn company noted this, and they quickly pivoted. They put together their clinical trials. They went to the FDA, and Rogaine for male pattern baldness actually launched ahead of the indication for heart disease. Now, I call this kind of innovation serendipity. It's a little bit like winning the lottery. It's very alluring. We hope that we will be that, you know, one in a million people that will win the lottery, but probably this is not the kind of innovation that most of us will be involved in. I'd also like to take a minute to talk about the innovations such as the iPhone or Uber or Airbnb or all of those innovations that we term unicorns. I call, certainly they're very transformational, they're very disruptive. A lot of times these types of innovations come on the market through a series of pivots. That was certainly the case with Airbnb, which started out leasing mattresses and then evolved into a company that offered leasing people's rooms and people's homes. But often, as you think about someone like a Steve Jobs, they also had a really strong marketing orientation. It was about observing people and looking at their habits and trying to come up with new ways to engage or entertain them. You know, certainly the idea behind the iPhone. I call these kinds of innovations the big hunt, right? So disruptive, transformative. We love to think about these as quintessential innovations, but again, probably not the kind of innovation that most of us will be involved in. I'd like to share a story about my early experience in innovation and one of the lessons that I learned. And I was working with a colleague who had licensed a technology from a lab in Israel. And this diagnostic could measure something called oxidative stress. So that's why I have a picture of New York City with a lot of smog, right? So oxidative stress is something that it addresses the or restricts the free radicals and puts a lot of strain on your body. But as it turned out, this oxidative stress that we were able to measure through this technology in just about any kind of body tissue, while it was super cool and very interesting, oxidative stress is a byproduct of just about every type of disease, from the heart failure to multiple sclerosis to any kind of disease in between. And so as we started to narrow down and look at indications, we quickly found that we had so many indications. The applications of this technology were so broad that we ran out of capital and investor patience in order to narrow it down to the one that we could ultimately take to market. And the technology ended up being outlicensed to a lab who integrated it with some other diagnostics. So I call this kind of technology the field of dreams. And if any of you are familiar with the Kevin Costner movie, Field of Dreams, where Shoeless Joe Jackson comes to the Kevin Costner character in a series of dreams and encourages him to build a baseball field in the middle of a cornfield in Iowa, build it and they will come. So I would say that this kind of innovation, particularly when we look at technology, happens most of the time. I would say practically 98% of the innovations that I see, and I work with Fortune 500 companies, I work with graduate students, I'm an advisor to principal investigators at any number of different universities and tech transfer offices. And so often individuals come up with that solution first, and then they have the problem of trying to figure out which problem to solve. That's a problem that you don't want to have. So I highly recommend that we not use the field of dreams approach to innovation. So then that leaves us with, well, what does work, right? Well, I'd like to share a story about a little known company at the time. This was back in the early 90s, and they saw a problem in the healthcare community. They recognized that there was a condition called Crohn's disease that hadn't seen a therapeutic advance in 40 years. It was still being used with a very gold standard but old drug called methotrexate. They had an idea about a pathway that was involved in Crohn's disease. It was the tumor TNF or tumor necrosis pathway. And they put themselves through a very paced methodological approach to designing an intervention that would stop the TNF pathway and therefore stop the cascade of activities that were leading to Crohn's disease. The reason I have the mouse on the slide is because they had an additional challenge or constraint that they had to work with. This was one of the first biologics that was being developed and planned for launch since the development of insulin back in around 1909. And so it was kind of falling on the heels of a lot of concerns about genetic manipulation, Dolly the sheep, biologics, creating drugs out of living organisms, which, you know, in this case, certainly included mouse cells. And so they really had an uphill battle, not only to solve the problem of bringing this drug to market, but of convincing and influencing stakeholders, patients, providers, that this therapy was safe and effective. Well, if any of you have come from the drug world, maybe you know where I'm going with this, but this is the drug Remicade, which not only was launched to treat Crohn's disease, but went on to be a treatment for rheumatoid arthritis. It's now part of the blockbuster class of medications. We've all heard of Humira, and has gone on to be a staple of the pharmaceutical industry. And, you know, suffice it to say that it has certainly created relief for any number of millions of patients. To me, this is innovation done right. It started with a clear understanding of a problem. It went through a methodological approach of developing that solution. It looked at risks along the way, because you can tell that there were risks and constraints, and it overcame them step by step. Now, I don't want to just leave us with product innovations, because I know that the work that a lot of us do might be at the forefront of process work or service work. So I'll give you another personal example. When I was working at Bristol Myers Squibb, I was working in clinical development. And one of our strong therapeutic areas at the time was diabetes. And we worked in the area of type 2 diabetes. We had a challenge to face because with one of our drugs, we needed to identify treatment naive patients. And at the same time, the FDA had given us a mandate to also reach out into underserved communities in order to do a better job of getting people diagnosed and on treatment. So we identified a problem. We needed to try to find undiagnosed patients. We needed to also boost the numbers of underserved that we included in our clinical trial. And so again, with a very clearly worded problem statement, we came up with a number of different solutions. The one that we ended up taking to prototype was a model whereby we had community workers work through schools and churches and food banks and other places in one geographic area in South Florida. And our goal was to see if working through these community workers and identifying individuals that could be brought forward to be diagnosed with diabetes and then put in the clinical trial, where the trial was actually beneficial to them because they might not have had money for healthcare, whether that could work, solve both of those problems. And indeed it did. And so our goal of recruiting a certain number of patients within that geographic area worked. We went on to extrapolate this solution and share it across the country. And I'm really happy to say that that particular drug trial came in 9 months ahead of time, which was pretty unheard of in the pharmaceutical industry. And that drug has gone on to treat large numbers of individuals with type 2 diabetes. Now, this innovation might not be as exciting as some of the others that I've described, and I consider it a little bit more of an incremental, a process improvement type of innovation, but it is still very valuable, and it's the kind of innovation, honestly, that those of us here today may find ourselves involved in, and I think that's a positive thing. So from my way of thinking about things, if I think about the sugar packet example of looking at the problem of table turnover, if I look at the problem that Centocor was trying to solve with a new treatment for Crohn's disease, and I even look at the problem that we were solving at Bristol-Myers Squibb in terms of trying to go in the community and help to identify diagnosed patients, these situations all have something in common. And what they have in common is that the innovation mindset journey starts with a problem. I think I probably have impressed that upon you at this point. It then goes on to identifying a solution. I'll go into a little bit more detail about this. That's law number two. We then take that solution to MVP, minimal viable product. If you don't have a product, we can substitute the word prototype, and I'll explain how that works. We then go on to a very important law, which is the voice of the customer. And I call it 100 customers can't be wrong. And I really insist on getting out there and talking with 100 customers. And I'll tell you why. We have to understand risk. You know, certainly you saw in the Centocor example that they looked at the constraints that they were dealing with. And risk can come in many forms, and it can really present an obstacle to us. So we have to be very honest about the risks that we encounter. And when we see these risks, and after we've talked with these customers, we have to be really agile and adaptable and get back to that idea of the innovation mindset. And so we have to pivot. And I like to say that you never fail. You're only pivoting. And as you pivot, you're learning. And as long as you're learning and bringing those learnings forward and continuing your process and continuing down the path, that's a positive thing. And you're adding to the continuum and the continuous process improvement of innovation. Obviously, your innovation can't stay under a rock. And so you have to be a good communicator, understanding who your audience is, putting a convincing message together. Innovators also have to be very influential. So it's very important that we communicate our message and do it well. And then the eight law is really about putting your plan together, understanding your business model, understanding your business plan. And oftentimes these pieces are coming together because you need to speak with investors. And I'll use this word broadly as well, because the investment could be that you're sitting in front of venture capitalists or private equity, but it could also be that you're sitting in front of the strategic team in your own company. And now you're sitting there getting ready for 2023 planning, and budget is being appropriated. And you want to make sure that your idea or your project is the one that is receiving the funds. So whether you're at the NIH or the DOD or a large pharma corporation or a big company like IBM, where I've been, you need to be able to put that plan together in a convincing way and influence others that they should invest in your big idea. So I thought what I would do at this point is talk a little bit about some of these laws. I'm not going to go into detail on all of them, but I did want to hit on a couple that I think are particularly important. So this first one is about identifying the problem. And so the innovator must solve a problem. And a lot of people ask me, well, you know, what makes a good problem? How do I know I have a good problem? Now, this is a picture of traffic in the Boston area. I could have taken one in DC and taken a picture of 395 or 95 or 270, and it probably would have looked familiar to you. But the whole idea here is that a problem needs to be observed. And I really advocate that you make yourself a student of observation. It is so easy to go through our day-to-day immune to what is right in front of us. And so if you are a student of observation, you look around yourself every day as an opportunity to solve a problem, like my dad did, which then leads to an opportunity to innovate, which helps you create an opportunity to foment change. Now, when we observe the problem, and this is why the traffic is a great example, it has to repeat itself. So we're not looking for something that's just a one-off, we've seen it one time. The traffic is also a great example because the impact has to be significant. It has to be measurable. Clearly, we have gridlock, people that can't get home in time. And it has to be specific and defined, right? So we know we have traffic at certain times of the day. Maybe certain sections of the Beltway have the gridlock. And importantly, your problem has to be solvable. And when I coach my students, I really encourage them to identify a problem that is solvable, because a lot of problems that we encounter can be very complex. They can have policy components and financial and economic components. They can be global in nature. They can be very worthwhile to solve, but they may not be things that we can have any influence over. And so I think to make innovation satisfying and to be successful at it, you have to find a problem that you can play a significant role solving. So I like to talk a little bit about what I call the problem-solving deconstruction methodologies. And I'll try to give you a little bit of an example, because again, this is a very important foundational principle or law, and it's the one that many people find difficult to get their arms around. So this deconstruction methodology, so taking the problem down to its nugget or its core, a first methodology is called first principles. And it's really just continuing to ask questions and deduce the root cause of the problem, bring it down to its most basic fact or truth. This is a principle, a deconstruction methodology that is very much a mindset of Elon Musk. So if you're familiar with the car battery story, when Elon Musk came onto the scene, the price of an electric car battery was about $60,000. And that's because of the price of the chromium and the cobalt and the lithium and the nickel, and there was a fifth component in the battery. So Elon Musk said, you know what, I'm going to be able to make this battery for $25,000. I'm going to cut the price in half. Everybody told him that he was crazy. He wasn't going to be able to do that. So what he did is he took the battery and he broke it apart. And he said, well, what are the components and what is the key component that's making the battery work? He determined that the most, and the battery was like 50% of the cost of the car. And 40% of the cost of the battery was in the component of the chromium. So if you look at a Tesla today, they include a car battery that has a chromium substitute. So, you know, this deconstruction methodology, let's break it into its parts. Let's now figure out the most expensive part. How do we further break that down and create a substitute for it? Great example of deconstruction. The whys, I say that if you've ever been the parent of a four-year-old, you know the deconstruction methodology of why, because that's what four-year-olds do. They keep asking why until you finally give them an answer that's satisfying to them. So you can certainly ask a question like why is it that way, you know, until you get to the root cause and you dig deeper. Analogy is a preferred methodology of Bill Gates. He said, why reinvent the wheel? What I do when I see a problem is I go out and I say, well, what does this look like? How has somebody else solved it? And if you think about the work that Gates is doing today with the Gates Foundation and his work with vaccines, and certainly his being on the scene with COVID, he's definitely looked for metaphors and analogies in the healthcare field and in the world of infectious diseases and vaccines as he tried to even predict what was going to happen with COVID and when the next big pandemic was going to occur, and suggesting what we needed to do in terms of readiness and preparedness. You know, definitely a component of the fact that he used this analogy. One of my favorites is called reframing, and I'm sure that you're all familiar with this too, but it involves looking at the problem through the lens of different stakeholders. That can be a really interesting thing to do, reframe the problem, or look at the problem inside out, just look at it from a different direction. So I like to give this example. The Disney company was actually facing a lot of challenges on their rides one spring because of very long queues, and people were complaining, and you don't want any unhappy customers in Disney. They determined that it was really going to be difficult to try to reduce the length of a line, but what they could do was possibly make standing in line more fun. And so if you were in the Magic Kingdom and you were in a very long line, you might be greeted by Mickey and Minnie and some of the other characters now playing with your children and entertaining you. And all of a sudden that 45 minutes went by very quickly. You didn't even notice it because you were having so much fun. That approach has actually been adopted on Broadway. And if you go into New York City to the Tix box and you're waiting for your ticket and now to stand in line to see your production, you'll find that oftentimes the actors, whether it's the SpongeBob crew or another acting troupe, will come out and interact with the patrons as they're waiting in line. So a great example of reframing. The example of a good problem statement, I'll just pause on this for a moment. You know, basically you have to be able to say what's wrong with what, how significant is it, who does it impact, and why do we care? And so I'm going to give this kind of fun example, but it is a true example that, you know, in a city area in India, the outdoor fruit market was being overrun by monkey troops that were coming in from the countryside looking for food. They were clearly very hungry. Okay, so what's wrong with what? We've got monkeys coming in from the countryside looking for food. These hungry, aggressive monkeys were toppling the vendor fruit carts, attacking the vendors, stealing fruit, and even scaring the tourists. So definitely causing complete mayhem to the tune of several thousand dollars in very short periods of time, like 1 month alone. Now, one of the challenges or constraints, because you find as you are trying to solve a problem, you've got to deal with these constraints, is that the Indian culture values all life, including animals. And so causing any harm to the monkeys was not permitted. So the solution was always to put them in a bus or a truck, take them back to the countryside, and then they would wait for them to come back into the city again. So I just give you that as an example of a good problem statement. I've used it with my students sometimes, and they've actually come up with really interesting solutions. The second law of innovation is that we have to start with at least three good ideas. As I said at the beginning, talking a little bit about my dad. And so when we talk about how to come up with big ideas, I like to talk about brainstorming methodologies. A lot of times people aren't sure how to start the process of developing solutions. Maybe you've got a solution that you think might work for you. But as I've mentioned, you really need to follow the law of three. Why the law of three? There's going to be the solution that you possibly have some bias toward. There is also a solution of doing nothing. So there's always a default, and your competition can always be the status quo. And we have to keep that in mind. And it's always good to have a third solution so that you can do some analysis and fit. And I'll talk a little bit about what that looks like. But some popular brainstorming methodologies could include storytelling. We do this a lot in the healthcare field. We might talk about the problem of the patient being in line in the diabetes clinic, or what it's like to be diagnosed with a childhood disease as you're getting diagnosed and treated, and what that is like for the patient and the child. A second methodology is what we call a big idea vignette. It can be very free forming and allowing the team just to come up with all sorts of not crazy, but you know, interesting and creative solutions to a problem, and then narrowing it down. And then one that I really like, and it's very popular, I think, in engineering and in the computer science and software world, which is user experience. So once you sort of understand what you want to happen or the experience that you want your customer to have, how do you model it out for them and let them know what this new experience is going to be like? I won't go into how to brainstorm, but a lot of times people do ask me, you know, are there ways that we should do this? And I really do believe that you got to put a time bound on it. You do have to let the ideas freely flow. You have to collect them. But the most important thing is you do not judge. You collect all the ideas, because what you're going to do next is prioritize. And a really important piece of getting to a solution is figuring out which solution has the best fit. And in this real life example for a project that I worked on for Walgreens, we laid out the solutions on this 2x2. We looked at the pros and the cons, and then we looked at the cost of each of the solutions and their benefit. Would this one have a big impact? And it would be a high level of effort, or it would be a low impact and it would have a low level of effort. You know, you get the picture. And then through that, you can try to isolate or down select your solutions into one, because ultimately you need one solution to take on to your minimal viable product. So what is your MVP and why do you care about that? An MVP can go by other terminology. Sometimes we might call it a target product profile, a prototype. You could call it a pilot. But the most important thing is you're going to create some very basic set of features, very basic, fundamental, just shows you that the thing works, in order to get something into a customer's hands early. It's great for creating early adopters of your product. It's good for getting customer feedback. It allows you to refine and improve the product or the service before you spent a lot of money on it. And it helps you to understand what features are the most beneficial to a customer. So you're not adding a whole roadmap of features. You're just coming down to a very basic question. And so you can reduce time and cost. Some examples of MVPs, these are in my book with definitions, but I'll just focus on one, this front door test. It's one of my favorite stories is about the online shoe brand Zappos, which I would imagine some of you have experienced Zappos. And it was the first online retail shoe company. And what Nick Swerman wanted to do was, he was actually looking for a certain kind of chukka boot. So it's a low profile boot that they would wear when they do some low impact hiking in the outskirts of LA. So he was looking for these boots. He couldn't find them at any of the retail stores. And when he finally did locate them, it was, you know, quite a far distance. And so he wondered whether individuals would be willing to buy shoes online. And he wanted to put this to the test, just wanted to find out if people would be willing to buy a hard to find shoe online. So he got a chukka boot. He also got a rare but premium brand of running shoe. He created a flyer. He went to a certain zip code in LA and he advertised the shoes and that you could buy them online on the flyer. He then created a landing page on a website. That's pretty much all that existed. And as the traffic came to the website and people put their orders in with their names and address, didn't take any money from them at that particular time. He literally physically went out throughout California in order to buy up the shoes. He would deliver them to the person's home and then he would charge them for the shoes. We call that a front door test because all he put up was this front page of a website, because all he wanted to know was, are people going to be willing to buy a shoe online? He proved that they were, Zappos was born and was very successfully exited to one of the huge online retailers, you know, some years afterwards. So I like that example because it just shows you how basic and practical your MVP can be if you really know what it is you're trying to understand. And so often, as we're creating that first solution, we try to lay too much into it. We want to think about every possible scenario that a customer could be in, and we want to try to solve all their problems. That's not what you're doing. It's just like Nick's question, do people want to buy shoes online? This is going to let me know whether they will or whether they won't. After the problem identification law, I think this is my second very favorite. It's the law of 100 customers. And this is a photo of Phil McKinney. Phil was the chief technology and innovation officer at Hewlett Packard for about 25 years. And he now is the president of Cablevision. He's moved on to look at how the cable industry can be more innovative. He's written a number of books. He has a podcast. He has great LinkedIn newsletters. And he's definitely, you know, still on the forefront of innovating. And he's profiled in my book. So what I like about Phil is when he was working at HP, he was really passionate about understanding the voice of the customer. So passionate that what he would do is he would go out to the circuit cities or Radio Shacks at the time, and he would stand in the aisles and he would look at how the customers were interacting with products, what they liked, what they didn't. He'd sometimes talk to them, and then he would come back to his team at HP. He would share what his findings were, and he would set them off to make their changes and improvements to the product. And ultimately, it's what kept them very competitive in the tablet and the gaming industry. So, you know, what's important in terms of the customer? It's understanding who is the customer, what work do they do, what are their pain points? These are some of the questions that you want to be asking. People often want to know how they get involved in doing customer research. So you can start with one-on-ones, focus groups, survey methodology. All of this is described in the book. Very quickly, because I know we're starting to run out of time here, the fifth law and my third favorite is about the ability to pivot. You know, so often we're down a path with our project or with our technology, and we become a little bit immune to market indicators, feedback from the customer, new constraints that are showing up in the environment, and we don't do what we need to do in order to change direction. And as I mentioned, a pivot is a change in strategy without compromising your vision. And if you need to pivot, it's an important thing to be aware of and to do on a regular basis if you need to, because if you're pivoting, you're never failing. All of this goes into your plan, your business model, the business plan that you put together, obviously really important. And I show this plan composition book because, you know, sometimes we just have scraps of paper that we're writing on, and, you know, you can do it electronically or in paper. I also like to talk about risk and the ability to de-risk your innovation. And risk can come from, there can be strategic risks, there can be technical risks if you're doing something that's technology-based. Clearly, you can have financial risk, operational risk. And if you do a little bit of a risk matrix, which I've got that schema in the book, you can actually do a risk matrix on your technology, look at those risks that are most likely to occur, then look at what their impact is of occurring, and then focus on de-risking to minimize impact. Clearly, there's no innovation without persuasion and communication. So it's very important to get that right, your marketing, your messaging, and I'll move on. And so the final rule that I'd like to share, and it's one of the reasons that I have that composition book up there, is I'd like to leave you with a homework assignment. And if you desire to be more innovative, if you think you've got a big idea and you haven't been able to bring it to the work environment or to a startup, I want you to observe 3 problems a day. But I want you to do more than that. I want you to get your notebook, your composition notebook, or your electronic notebook, and I want you to write them down. And I want you to do this every day And at the end of 2 weeks, I guarantee if you look back at that list, you will see things that you're interacting with on a day-to-day basis at work, at school, in your environment. And there you will find problems to solve, and you may find the innovation that you are meant to take to market. So if I might, Cambiz, just leave with 2 minutes here on this fabulously produced book trailer. And the reason I want you to see it is because at the end, I've got some of the fabulous innovators that are profiled in the book, and you just have to listen to this and see them, and then we'll be done.
Every great idea starts with a problem. How can we do things better, more effectively, more profitably, more equitably? The solution to that problem is sometimes a eureka moment, sometimes an insight that flashes into our minds only after long, disciplined thinking and research. How do you turn that moment, that insight, into a successful business? Hi, I'm Lorraine Marchand, and my book, The Innovation Mindset, 8 Essential Steps to Transform Any Industry, acts as a handbook to help make your big idea a reality. So many products never make it to market because of the failure to address the problem that customers need solved. This comprehensive and easy to follow guide will show you how to fine tune your ideas and share them with the world. In my career, guiding Fortune 500 companies and startups launching their ideas, one thing I learned is that innovation comes from within. Without the proper mindset, your ideas and dreams will always be held back. That's why we've identified a series of principles or laws, as we call them in the book, that help guide you in the process of being more innovative. The mindset includes traits such as passion, curiosity, and a willingness to embrace change. But this mindset can look different on every innovator, so don't just take it from me.
The biggest characteristic of an innovator is somebody who's willing to fail.
I think that curiosity is the single most important quality for innovators and entrepreneurs.
What is it that I'm really providing an audience? Is it sound? And what I came up with is that it's engagement.
And so you start right out using your artistic vision to solve problems. We've included stories and testimonials from some of the world's leading innovators, sharing their secrets and tips that can help you turn your flash of insight, your aha moment, into a successful new venture. Your innovation journey starts here with the innovation mindset. 8 essential steps to transform any industry.
Okay. I'm sorry that I went a couple minutes over there, Cambiz, but I'm see that we've got a chat full of questions. That's very exciting. Very happy to see.
Well, thank you so much. It was very educational. We have actually questions already received. So I'm going to, I'm going to bring them out, and if you can answer, that would be great. And let's just start with this question. I think you have given us an exercise, but the questioner asks, can curiosity be taught? Or is it just come, from, your instincts, and how does it work?
Yeah, I love that question. So thank you for asking it. And again, I think, whether you've been a parent or an aunt or uncle or anybody that's been exposed to a 3 or 4 year old, you see natural curiosity, right? So children have a natural curiosity. They're unabashed about their questions, about searching. And I think what happens is, as we get into school, we find that it becomes more and more important to learn, to know the rote exercises. And then as we become professionals and go into our working world, the currency there is knowing all the answers. And so I think what happens is curiosity gets buried very deep in us as we become adults and as we find that we need to have all the right answers. And so to some extent, what you have to do is unpack that and get back in touch with your natural curiosity. So I absolutely believe that there is a natural innateness to it. And some of the reasons that I like to talk about that story of being 13 is a lot of times I will ask my audience, think back on what you were doing, what you were creating, what you wanted to be when you were 12 or 13. It's a very formative time in everybody's life, right? That kind of post-adolescent, preteen time. And it's amazing what comes forward, the creative ideas or the dreams that people had about what they wanted to be or what they wanted to do. And so you have to get back to that.
Okay. Well, good. Thank you so much. We have Ellen Nelson asking, and I'm going to quote, he has or she has a killer app that he or she intends to make accessible to everyone for free. Attracts affiliates, but by the thousands, and scalable worldwide, and shares 50% of the revenue with affiliates. He or she has markets identified and knows to whom he or she should contact. What tips, in addition to buying your book, of course, can you offer to write market-specific emails that won't be automatically discarded? I guess this is also a problem we face. How do we bring ideas in the area of filters and spam and basically rising above the noise?
Okay, so the individual, can you just restate the question, Cambiz, so I can?
Yeah, basically is a killer app. Mm-hmm. The market's identified, the scalable. Any tips that you can offer to write market specific emails
that
won't be automatically discarded?
Oh, I see. So the person wants to market the app through emails to customers.
Or I guess in general sense, probably how to direct marketing effort to the right pockets of people to get noticed.
Yeah. Well, I think that goes back to this, voice of the customer and the 100 interviews that you need to conduct. And so I think if you've done some sort of a prototype of your killer app, if you've presented it to them, the thing that I would do is ask individuals in different segments, where do you like to receive information? Where would you want to hear about my product? What would be most, accessible or interesting to you? And then I would probably do some segmentation of those profiles and those preferences. And then I would probably put together my multi-channel marketing campaign, along those lines. So I think it requires some kind of segmentation exercise. But again, the more you know about your customer and what their preferences are, the more you can design your outreach in a way that's interesting and compelling to them. So that's my short answer. I'd be happy for you to connect on LinkedIn and we could have a lengthier conversation.
Okay, that's perfect. Again, I would like to ask everyone, if you have any questions, please use Q&A box, and we have about 30 minutes to cover them. Here's a question about, I think you touched on this with what you called reduction. Does innovation include optimization of an existing product or service? For example, you mentioned Apple, the iPhone. Some of the basic ideas that iPhone mastered were available before, like Palm. Different manufacturers were doing it, but nobody did this supply chain as efficiently as Apple. So I'm assuming that is also considered an innovation. If innovation is a process optimization.
Yes, I think that innovation occurs on a continuum. And if we think about that continuum with the big hunt, the transformative ideas on one side of the spectrum, and then what I showed is incremental innovation, which you could also call optimization, on this side of the spectrum, to me, all of that encompasses innovation, because at its heart, innovation is about bringing something new to the marketplace in order to solve a problem. So if something was available and used in this way or this domain, and now it's being used in this way, I think that's an improvement. And, certainly there can be supply chain optimization. And I think that, to me, that is a form of innovation. I'm sure we could have a debate with a lot of other innovation philosophers who would disagree and maybe would be purists. But, honestly, I want to encourage people to think and solve problems. And so I don't mind that the word innovation is very commonly used. I mean, a while back, we would would refer to digital marketing or e-marketing. Now we just say marketing, or now we just say social marketing, right? And I think it's a good thing that we have this mindset so ubiquitously spread that people are just naturally thinking about ways to solve problems, whether it's incremental, whether it's optimization. So I encourage optimization as a form of innovation.
Okay. So basically Walmart is a great example. They mastered the supply chain. There's really, that is the innovation for good or bad, you know, right?
Absolutely. Yeah.
So actually we have a question on basically sustainability or ESG as it were. Do you consider, you have different criteria or, you know, ideas, you know, what is innovation? Do we need to consider the quality of what we want to solve? Does it make life sustainable, or does it carry any bigger value in the society as a metric, or you know, innovation could go in any direction?
Well, that's a very thoughtful question, and I certainly agree that we want innovation. We want to encourage innovations that will improve culture, improve society. You know, I gave some early examples of what was happening during COVID, or what we're doing to help the fighting in the Ukraine. So I personally think that value-based innovation is very important. Social innovation is important. I encourage that. And I think increasingly it is important to innovators. And it's one of the reasons why I think it's really important to encourage more diversity among innovators, right? I think the more we bring in different voices from different walks of life, we're going to land on problems that are important to other people, whether they're social problems or value-based problems or whatever it is. And so I think that's going to infuse more of the ESG mindset into innovation, the more diversity we have. I mean, innovation as a definition, it does come along with the idea that you want to have some kind of commercial impact. But that aside, you can also want to have impact on a market segment or an audience, and it can be for social good. It can be for a not-for-profit. So I do encourage, and I think increasingly we're seeing more ESG and more value-based innovation. I think that's very positive.
Okay. And actually you hit on two of the questions I want to ask. One question was, do you see a pattern that teams are better for that innovative core, or is it individually driven? And if it's a teams are more prone to success, do we need to have one of each personality types? And all is are the studies done, or is it basically it could be success could be in any of them, start with any of them?
Yeah, no, I think that's a terrific question too. And, I recently did a workshop at a major pharmaceutical company, and one day of the workshop, they did the Lencioni's, I think it's called the genius. He has six geniuses that he describes. And so it's a way to kind of profile and or create archetypes of the ways people think and how creative they are and how innovative they are. And it's interesting when you do that, because everybody's got a different strength. Maybe somebody really loves the idea of innovation, but they're stronger at the operational or the implementation part of it. Maybe somebody is like, thinks about big ideas, but doesn't have any interest in actually doing the implementation. Maybe somebody's got a real penchant for the market research piece, and they really want to understand what the customer's thinking. So absolutely. I mean, companies are enabled by teams, and I think high performing teams all bring different skills and experiences and talents to the fore. And the more you can get that blended, and now you have everybody thinking the innovation mindset as a group, you know, encouraging each other with the curiosity, encouraging the problem solving, I think that's very, very powerful. So absolutely like to see teams come together, understand each other's strengths, and how that can all be brought to bear to make a team that's innovative and can make the change.
Okay. And you also mentioned You alluded to the fact that we measure success. I think you basically mentioned financial success. What is a measure of success? Financial is easy, you know, product sales or services adopted. Are there any other ways? Are there innovations that never make it to financial success?
Yeah. Well, there certainly are innovations where, like, the financial metric isn't so critical to them. So, you know, again, if we think about what's been happening with respect to trying to bring vaccines into third world countries, or, you know, using the Nokia phone throughout South Africa in order to send out positive diabetes messages. I mean, these didn't necessarily lead to commercial success, but they certainly raised the health and the economic standards of countries. And so that's a very worthy cause, right? To empower people, to educate people, to give them more access, to give them, you know, better jobs and financial security. So I think those are also very positive metrics of innovation. So yeah, it certainly doesn't have to be only commercial and only financial. I was just saying that that's more or less kind of the formal definition, but I also said that what I'm embracing is having a definition that's much broader, that's much more inclusive, and that lets a lot of people from different walks of life bring their new ideas to market and solve problems that matter to them.
Well, thank you so much. Here's a question, basically for every, you know, for startups, for every innovator, group of innovators, there are people who do fund that. You know, they have to evaluate it. And they have to decide if this is worth funding, has a future or not. Is there a way that a funder, a venture capitalist, look at an innovation differently, or basically the same metrics apply for the person who actually wants to make them, and as opposed to funding them?
So the investor is looking at whether this innovation is going to be able to make it to the commercial marketplace and is going to produce a certain amount of revenue and profit and return to them in some window of time, the window of time that's their curtain for needing to make money on the product. So the laws that I lay out pretty much follow what an investor is going to be looking for. First of all, the investor is going to want proof that you're solving an important, significant problem that a customer is willing to pay for. That's going to be their cardinal question, right? They're also going to want to know that you interrogated a number of solutions and went through some sort of fit process and tested your solution through a minimal viable product. Most investors, VCs, will want to see that you've talked to 100 customers. I've seen some of them request 300 customers, depending upon how many segments there are. So they're going to be very dependent on market landscape information and your customer research. So those are going to be the critical things that they're looking for. They're going to want to understand how you're going to spend the money. So you have to have a plan or a roadmap that shows milestones and shows, you know, incremental improvement, revenue gain, profitability along those milestones so that they know that you're growing, that you're being successful, and that there are different inflection points where they're going to see their revenues increase. So in the book, I talk about the idea of putting your business model together. That would be the idea of how are you going to make money, and certainly being able to put a business plan together, and then having that 10-slide pitch from the problem through the customer, all the way through how they're going to make their money, what that forecast is. I've got a template in there where you can have a very compelling conversation with the investor in 10 minutes to get them interested. And then from there, it's a series of conversations where you go into more and more detail. But yes, the investor is going to want to make sure that at the end of this, they're making money. Now, I should also caveat that with the fact that there are a growing number of investors. We talked about ESG, who are interested in social good, and they may not have as you know, firm, hard metrics, but I would say that there are also individuals that may be high net worth individuals that have money to invest in a problem and they want to see social good come out of it. And they're more foundation, not for profit oriented. So you'll find that if you have that kind of idea, I wouldn't be swayed not to move forward. I think you'll still find interested parties willing to work with you, but your typical VC is going to be looking for their return on investment.
Okay. So part of your answer, basically you're saying that innovation, the time and effort that takes to nurture that innovation is also part of the innovation. So it's just kind of a journey. It's not just an idea just coming. So then that begs this question, which we received, is there a time to leave? So you see people that stay maybe long, at the top, and could they become, if you don't turn this wheel on to produce innovation, should we know there is a time for an innovator to leave and let the new blood come in?
Yes. Well, that's a good question too, and a very hard one sometimes for an innovator to grapple with. I think in terms of the innovator and the idea, I really do encourage this idea of pivoting. Like if you have a vision and you have a direction that you want to head in, and you're going down a certain path and you find out that it's not resonating with customers, your forecast isn't coming in, market dynamics have changed, the competitors are eating your lunch, so to speak, then you need to take all that insight, you need to talk to the customers, and you need to determine how you can change direction to better solve their problem. If after doing that, you still are coming up with the fact that maybe the marketplace has really changed and your innovation is no longer needed and it's time to close up shop and do something different, then yes, I do think that there are situations where you need to do that. I was actually involved in something one of the companies that I co-founded was an ophthalmic diagnostic company. And for a lot of reasons not related to the particular product, the market kind of passed us by. We lost a little bit of time. And so we had to be very honest with ourselves that the customers, the marketplace didn't really need the particular product that we were developing. We pivoted and we ended up designing a solution that fit for pharma companies that were doing drug discovery and development. But the idea of doing this point of care diagnostic was no longer viable. But that's what I mean by pivoting. A lot of times you don't have to give up that overall vision of having an impact or that idea, but you do have to be willing to make some changes in direction. And certainly there are examples of companies that pivot too late. You look at Blockbuster right there. I mean, there are a lot of companies that are quintessentially have failed because they didn't stay innovative, because they didn't stay close to the customer, because they were dismissive of the competition. I mean, look at what's happened with the taxi industry, right? With Uber. So yes, that can happen if you're not, if you don't have a good conscience or a good friend reminding you to be honest with yourself.
Okay. Well, actually that is, I just thought about this question. You're familiar with Theranos, right? You just mentioned the diagnostic company that, didn't read the market correctly, but these guys were very innovative.
Yes.
In a sense that they decided that they have the innovation, but all they have to do is buying time and maybe some devious ways, but then got ahead of them. Do you have any, are these common? I don't think it's common, but $10 billion companies are common, but probably a lot of people who do fake it and they never succeed. What is your take on
that? Yeah, I guess fortunately, I do think that those are the exception rather than the rule. I mean, Theranos is a very dramatic example of someone who sold a vision, right? An idea of something that was possible, and then created a whole facade and, lied about the data, including to her own internal team. And obviously was a very sick individual as she put all these, put these lies forward. But it can show you, really what it shows you is like the psychology of individuals that want to believe something almost too good to be true, right? And so the investors believed and they kept putting money into it. And she was very compelling and attractive and like a female version of a Steve Jobs. And, you know, she just had everybody in awe, and folks that were involved really didn't do their diligence or ask the tough questions. So I think that individuals, certainly investors, can be guilty of a little bit of a herd mentality. And we see some companies, you know, today that are missing their valuations and disappointing shareholders because there was a lot of hype, too much marketing and a lot of hype in what they were going to deliver. And there really wasn't anything there. So it means that if you are an innovator, get back to the root of that problem, make sure you've got a bona fide solution. You know, certainly put a compelling business case together. And certainly if you're someone who's investing, you need to do your diligence. And if something sounds like it's too good to be true, you know, it probably is. So unfortunately, I hate to see innovators tainted with that sort of thing, but it does happen.
It does happen. Well, I have a question, and this is our last question. And we have a comment, which we're going to go through, but, imagine that you go to an established company, like an American car manufacturer. They have done, you know, manufacture car the way most, you know, used to, the way they used to manufacture cars. As a coach, if you were hired as a consultant to go and you're asked to create an environment that encourages innovation. Mm. For an established company, what are the elements you generally look at? You look at the sizes, you look at if people communicate better. What are the elements that could change in an established company?
Yeah, that's a great question, and I'm thinking of writing a book about that.
Right. I mean, we had, by the way, the reason is that we had actually couple of years ago, 2-3 years ago, we had a chief technology officer of NASA, this is a Columbia grad, talked about the stories, the way they learned after the disaster, shuttle disaster, how to look at the problem, how to, it was just reinvigorating something that they stopped doing. Basically, they fell through a routine and never saw dangers, and then there was a wake-up call. So yes. That's what I'm asking.
Yeah. I think that, you know, number one, if I had to think about the most important principle, especially for a large corporation, innovation has to start at the top. So it has to be an important value, behavior, practice, and from the CEO, and that CEO has to embolden his or her executive team, and give them the resources, the time, everything that they need. If you want your company to be innovative, it has to start with the leader. Number two, as Spencer Raskoff from Zillow pointed out, you have to be willing to fail. I say you pivot, you never fail. But I do think that there's something that we can learn from the kind of culture that Jeff Bezos created at Amazon, and he coined the phrase, try, fail, learn. And he said, you know what, if you're not failing, you're not trying. And if you're not trying, you're not learning. So I want to incent you to try as many things as possible. I hope that you will fail. And I'm actually going to reward and recognize the failure because I want you to try. Like, innovation is a team sport. Get out there and do it. So you have to create what I call a safe environment that encourages failure. It can't be about every innovation leads to a new product on market or the optimization that's going to grow market share. Innovation isn't cultivated in sort of a quarter by quarter numbers kind of environment, right? It's got to be fomented in a place of willing to experiment. It's experimentation. And then I think the third one, to your point, is it goes back to this idea of risk, right? And constantly looking at the risk, not falling in love with your own product so much, not getting immune and failing to see the symbols that are right around you, and kind of having a can-do attitude where nobody brings the truth forward, right? And you don't have sort of a transparent culture where it's okay to say, you know what, I disagree, or I saw something that, you know, wasn't right. When I was at BMS, we were accused of being a can-do culture, and everybody would take on every project, and they would have this drug in development for 5 and 6 and 10 years and spend all this money on it, you know, only to find out that they got nowhere. And so at some point they said, you know what? We want to innovate, but we want to be smart about it. And we're going to have to get rid of this can-do culture. We can't do everything. We're going to have to ask ourselves some tough questions, and we're going to have to, you know, pay attention to some of the feedback and in the intelligence, you know, in the marketplace in order to know what we're doing well and what we're not doing well. We can't continue to be immune to all of the signs and signals around us. Okay. So I think the Challenger story is a good analogy of that.
Okay. Well, commenter Dr. Harriet Fields, one of our, the most faithful audience members and members, basically mentions that the methodology can be applied to disparities of income and service access, or access to jobs, decent education, reducing environmental pollutants, fixing global climate change, access to primary health care in underserved areas, because it's increasing more in this country, which is an accountable model for democracy. So hopefully there is a feedback loop that people listen to and, you know, finally do something about it.
Wonderful. That's a very insightful comment. Thank you for sharing that. Very, very nice. And I appreciate you sharing it during this book talk.
Yeah. Well, we are running out of time. I would like to ask you if you have any comments. But before that, basically, I tell everyone that we recorded this and we're going to post it within 24 hours. We also send the link to the book from Columbia University Press, as well as the discount code, which is, I think, about 20% off. So yeah. That is an innovative way to buy a book. With that said, any final thoughts in addition to your exercises that we have to do, your final thought on innovation?
I just say jump in. If you feel as though you have an idea and this is an itch that you need to scratch, do it. So often it's easy for us to put it off, and we have other obligations and work and families and pressure, and the time is never right. The time is never going to be right. But if it's something that is an ache in you or something that's niggling at you, I really hope that you'll give it a try. It's one of the reasons that I encourage that exercise of observing problems and writing them down, you know, in your diary and looking back at them and figuring out the problems that you can solve. And maybe there'll be a nugget in there that will inspire you. So I want to make innovation accessible to all. I think it's a way to feel very fulfilled. I think that we all want to find our passion. We all want to be productive in a way that speaks to our energy and our values and our passion for whatever it is that we're doing. And I think it's a way to have a very fulfilling career. And I don't view a career as a destination. I very much view it as a journey. And I think it's going to have different arcs. And I absolutely think that innovation and getting your ideas out there can be part of your own career arc. So whether you're doing it at a big company, whether you're going to start something up in your basement, whether you're going to fix something at your kid's school, just do it.
All right. Well, thank you so much. We're really looking forward to bring you back. You apparently have other ideas in the works. So you know where to find us, and we find you, actually. Thank you, our audience, for spending your evening with us. And until the next time, goodbye.
All right. Thank you very much, Cambiz. It's been my pleasure, and I hope to hear from you all on LinkedIn. Would love to continue the dialogue.
We'll do.